Welcome, everyone, to the Planning Board meeting. We've been doing some administrative things first, for those who are just joining us on TV. And we are into kind of the agenda for a few items yet. We've continued the public hearing for this Marathon Solar and to the 15th of September, and Laurel Avenue extension has been withdrawn without prejudice. And we've approved some minutes and appointed a bunch of people to Zach. And right now, I think we're next up is talking about the Hopkinton Center for the Arts. So come on down, Chuck and Dan. I believe we have before us is the final set of prints that
I hope so.
Yep.
We're all set for here. So this is what we had talked about, I think, at our last meeting. So did everyone else feel that it was what we wanted? If it is, what do I need? A motion to consider it a minor amendment and then so prove it, meaning that it meets all the standards?
You've already determined it's a minor amendment, so just vote to...
That it meets all the standards and accept this change.
Weren't we looking for a landscaping plan?
We submitted the landscaping. Yeah.
Okay,
that's what was missing last time was the landscape plan.
Okay, that's all been caught. Yep. I didn't get a chance to see that part.
This landscaping by the parking lot, by the school parking lot, that's stuff you're doing?
Let me see which one you're looking at. Right.
This road?
No, those are there?
Yes.
Oh,
yeah, these four, in conjunction with the Al Rogers, we took out because they were diseased.
Okay.
But the bulk of them are still there.
Yeah, they're all there. That was done as part of the high school project.
You say it's nice of you to do that for the school.
Okay. Looking for a motion to find that it meets the criteria and to approve the changes.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And we got a nice letter from Jean. And
good.
So,
all right.
Thank you. We will see you in
a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. I think we're now back to the Marathon Solar letter. Did everyone get caught up?
Mm-hmm.
You all set? Any comments, questions about the letter?
I think it's pretty straightforward, counting of everything, and I appreciate the summary.
It is a pretty good summary. I thought Elaine did an excellent job on responding. So look for a motion to send a letter to... Oh, John?
So moved.
Oh, okay. Moved.
Second.
Seeing further discussion? Seeing none? How do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. So we're waiting patiently for our Ash Street Scenic Roads hearing. This time I'll remind you that at our next meeting we've got two public hearings scheduled, and then on the meeting on September 28th we're working on the master plan, so everyone's got a chapter and some homework to do for the next month, and let's hopefully get it in maybe before this, a couple days before the 26th, you know.
So it can be distributed.
And you know, there's going to be a lot of reading to do, so sooner is better on that than later. Are there any board member comments, questions, liaison reports. CPC is starting up this fall. We'll be holding hearings in September and October for new projects. So anyone that's interested in a CPC-funded project that's coming along. I think that's the only thing that I might have in the liaison report area. Fortunately, that clock is even a couple minutes fast. At 8 o'clock, we're going to call into our member, Frank Sebo, all the way from Shanghai, trying to call in today. We'll see if that works.
What time is it there?
It is actually 12 hours difference, so he is...
Working up.
8 a.m.
He is in the morning, I guess, of tomorrow.
Good.
So...
Hopefully he wasn't waiting for us yesterday.
And it's obviously all this market meltdown is all Frank's fault.
Am I next up, Mr. Chairman, at 8 o'clock?
What?
Am I next up at 8 o'clock?
Yes, you are. You guys can all get ready.
You guys, it's me. We lost power, so everything's digital.
Okay.
Well,
that's probably not bad.
A massive tree fell across all the lines on Fruit Street.
Really?
Yeah.
No.
Just decided to let go, or what?
Yeah.
Today?
It's tree warden's fault, I guess.
What kind of... It wasn't the marijuana plants.
Yeah, they fell on the line.
Yeah, if they were on Ash Street, we'd need a scenic road here and get rid of the plants.
Is that right?
We have not been this early with this much dead time in ages.
Oh, I know.
Can we talk about where the planning board is considering sidewalks in the future beyond this existing section?
We could do that, because that's...
Do you have any ideas?
I have an idea based on what we saw for the library plans now is maybe the east side of Church Street from where it ends. Mm. It goes on the west side, but from there down to Church Place. Mm-hmm. That's my new idea today.
Okay.
I think you were looking at potentially some more on the eastern side of Hayden Row, where the new school area might be going, as a potential sidewalk, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
I've seen some correspondence from some residents of the downtown area talking about Cedar Street from C Street to A Street. People like to
oh.
The loop, but
there's
a
mystery.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Hi, Mike Calduca, 5 Carriage Hill Road. Have you folks considered Holt Street? Holt is a major cut through used by children going back and forth to school. And the great sidewalk you put in already with the extension, it would give people an excellent long distance walking path to cut all the way around. Basically, do a 3 or 4 mile loop around the town. See a lot of nice houses.
That's probably a good idea, and then kind of on that same idea, we have a few unbuilt streets that go from Blueberry to the, I'll say, EMC Park.
Mm-hmm.
We might build walking paths.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll, not miss, you know, that would get us either to the park or get us, I think there's Fitch Street and another street that are laid out where there is potential. I mean, that's through the woods.
Would the planning board consider doing another survey?
Yeah.
When we have a new IT director.
Well, yeah.
I don't know whether people are at the mood of wanting to spend lots of money right now, given the fact that we have spent fortunes at the last town meeting and are looking at a $40 million school coming up. I'm not sure whether we can, I don't know. But there might be a grant program.
Could be. I will tell you, though, in my 30 years, the sidewalks on Ash Street are the most welcomed and appreciated construction project that I've ever done. It was incredible, the response.
You don't get the same response out of a sewer treatment plant?
I know they're ready to look at those 19 trees. It was scary.
Oh, yeah.
It was really scared out there.
I was going out to look at the 19 trees, and I see Kobe and Elaine and Don McAdams walking down Ash Street taking their lunchtime jog or walk. Okay, I think it is 8 o'clock. Okay, you give him a call, and let's hope. Not the other side of the world. The other side of the world is kind of right where that Malaysian plane is. It's, if you actually go through the...
Hi, Frank. It's the plane.
Do you know where the
board?
Plane is?
Hey, Frank.
Ni hao.
Frank, are you responsible for the stock market meltdown?
Yes, personally. I am doing my best to turn it around.
Okay. It's 8 o'clock here and 8 o'clock there. I'd like to open the Scenic Road public hearing for Ash Street Sidewalk, Town of Hopkinton. This is a proposal to remove 19 trees and the alteration of two sections of stone wall for the construction of a new sidewalk on Ash Street from Hearthstone Road to Blueberry Lane. What I guess I'd like to do is maybe, and we have the tree warden present here, and John Westerling from the DPW, maybe just a general quick overview, and then we'll take some general public comments, and then we're going to go tree by tree down the road. And thumbs up, thumbs down on each tree and crossing as we go right down the road. So,
thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, members of the Planning Board. As the Chairman said, this is a tree hearing to accommodate the construction of a new sidewalk along the westerly side of Ash Street. That's an extension of where we ended our construction last year. And it will extend from Hearthstone to Blueberry. It will include the installation of two new stone head walls where we have to extend two of the culverts, two new pedestrian wood rails, the relocation of two small portions of what, quote-unquote, stone walls, and a removal of 19 trees, all of which are marked with white paint. By a dot in the field. And those range from, there are eight trees of 3-inch diameter all the way up to a single tree of a 38-inch diameter. I do have the plans with me. And the reason that we have to cut 19 trees is that we're extending the sidewalk in order to stay within the right-of-way and proximate to the edge of roadway. This is the only location that we can locate the sidewalk, and those trees happen to coincide with the location of the sidewalk.
Okay. General comments from people first. We've kind of had an introduction, but we're going to go tree by tree, so if your concern is like one of the trees, then hold it off till we go at that point. General support for the sidewalk project? Is that a yes, no? Yes, sir. Name and address, please.
Yep, Dave Wilson, 54 Ash. John, I heard you mention two
construction of two stone walls in this project. Could you elaborate on materials that you plan to select?
Absolutely. There are, pardon me for those folks that are behind, but in general, there are two existing culverts that we have to extend. There's one here, and there's one here. There's one just to the south of Hot Stone, and one just to the north of Stone Crossing. So we'll be extending those culverts to be able to accommodate the 5.5-foot wide sidewalk. They will be field stone in mortar, and on top of them, we will construct, we're going to have wooden rails to keep the pedestrians from falling off of the edge of sidewalk.
And Frank, you got that in your package, basically, the picture you're showing.
Is this a section in front of 64?
Yes. No, this is the just behind those two culverts.
Well, I have a culvert in front of 64.
Okay, so 64. What about 64? I'm sorry, I don't have the
bottom page.
Are you one of the stone walls that has to be reconstructed or further down?
No, I'm one of the stone walls and a culvert.
Okay.
It's got to be somewhere right
around. So here's, I think I found it here, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
There's a stone wall here
66.
That we identified for the wall the wall to be moved back, just the stones, okay. Probably
that looks
1 foot.
Right, that's my driveway. So.
Yeah, about 1 foot worth of the stones have to be moved back. And then this is one of the culverts here where we will be extending and constructing the headwall. There's an existing culvert here, but we are not proposing to put any extension there. We're going to put a manhole to accommodate some of the perimeter drain.
Will that be covered? And we'll go across that? Because that's the ditch right now.
Yeah. Again, if you know, if you're headed towards Stone Crossing, there is the stream crossing. That's where we will have the wooden rail behind the sidewalk. There'll be nothing here. There'll be a manhole flush to the roadway.
So that ditch will be filled in and there'll just be a manhole there?
Yeah, there'll be a manhole within the location of the existing the proposed sidewalks.
Is there a drain there?
There is not.
That is the lowest point of the road.
But there's an existing drain there, correct?
There is a culvert going across here.
Yeah.
There's a ditch there.
Yeah.
And there is no drain. I mean, it just flows down there. This is the lowest part of Ash Street.
Yep.
And if you don't put a drain there, this is going to flood.
That's where the existing catch basin is, correct?
There's no catch basin.
There isn't?
Just a ditch and a culvert going across the road.
So the ditch has an inlet to the
yes.
culvert. Okay. So this, it's a special drain manhole. I do not have the detail here with me, but what it is going to allow the perimeter drain coming down to capture that groundwater, and it will also have an inlet on the curbing side, so it will allow the water to enter and exit across Ash Street as it currently does.
Okay, that's got to be big enough because this whole area in here floods every spring, mm-hmm. and I have up to 2 feet of water standing in here.
Is that because of the wall that's there?
It's because, yeah, the wall that's there and it can't flow through properly.
Yep.
The problem is just like what we talked about, John, before, is everything on, I guess that would be the west side of Ash, the water just flows right out of the hillside
mm-hmm.
onto the street and down the street and continues on. Then you've got the stream from the pond in the back, and all that water just comes down onto the street, or in this case, down his culvert, where he's talking about.
So
that storm we had 6 years ago where it swamped downtown? I had 3 feet of standing water on my property.
There is to pick up the water that weeps out of the roadway currently and behind the new sidewalk, we're going to be installing a French drain down the edge of the roadway that will capture the water that's weeping out in front of your house and all the way down to the low point in the roadway. And it sounds like what you've got there is something that we need to look at beyond just the sidewalk project, because if you've got water that's standing up on the edge of Ash Street, it's not getting to that culvert. We need to do something more there beyond just this, the scope of this project. But maybe we can look at that and we can accommodate something for an inlet in this new manhole.
Is that whole area there used to be an existing structure like 75 years ago?
Okay.
And there was a foundation there, and that foundation slowly is being filled up, but it's still below street level.
Okay. Happy to look at that with you in the field so that we can see what we can do to accommodate the water needs there.
But I guess I'll go back to my original.
Yes.
So based on the walls that you're going to construct, you're going to use a field stone product that has water behind it.
Correct.
Not cement.
Correct.
Not granite.
Correct.
So I'll propose, I know this is a tree meeting that we're supposed to be talking about, but don't you think that that will look contradictory to the existing wall that is in place that you're putting in the last phase?
It is a different material, and as you and I spoke through the planning board, through the chairman, the abutter was not satisfied with the granite that we had put up in front of his property, and we had looked at a couple of options, and what I had said was that when this contractor is selected, we're going to get a price from them so that we can consider removing that granite and building a field stone wall. But we couldn't do that absent a contractor because the granite's tied into the bituminous concrete of the existing sidewalk. We didn't want to just pull that out with having a contractor there who could make the necessary repairs. So we're going to look at that, and we're going to get a price and consider that with the abutter.
The 40-foot section in front of 64 that you're restructuring?
Yes.
Is that just going to be removed, restructured, and not had any concrete or anything put in it?
Correct.
Why don't we start with number one and just march straight down the street? I think tree number one is a 4-inch sugar maple. This is near 54, I believe.
Yep.
I had a question on those two. They're very small trees, so they're not a big issue. But where they are is adjacent to new sidewalk that's already gone in. So why are those here?
Excellent question. As I stated, we're going to be installing a French drain behind the existing sidewalk. If you can see it here, and the details should show on your plan, there's a dotted line. That's the French drain that will capture the water that's weeping out of the hillside.
Oh, okay.
If we don't put in that French drain, we're not going to be able to capture that water, and we'll have that icing problem.
All right.
Even worse, down the sidewalk and down the roadway.
Got it.
Okay. I thought those first two trees, which are small sugar maples, had no visual impact, and they weren't much of trees per se. I mean, it seemed like there was a lot of mass behind it.
No, I agree with you. I just didn't realize the drainage was the reason. I just saw that the sidewalk was already in, so I couldn't figure out what we're talking about these two trees.
Okay, so are there any objections to one and two coming out? Okay. Now the third one is a 3-inch elm, I believe, and that's kind of still in the vicinity of 54-ish. I didn't take any really notes on that tree, so I'm not sure that tree had anything when I was looking at it. Anyone here have any objections with that one? Okay.
Those are all little saplings at 56
yep.
Ash there.
Right. Okay, then I'm looking at number four, which is a 4-inch sugar maple. My notes, when I looked at it today, I saw no visual impact if it was gone. Everyone else agree, or I'm not seeing any objection to that, number four. Number five is a 3-inch something thorn?
Buckthorn.
Can you, instead of, in the sheet I have from Elaine, they're identified by the number Ash Street, so I'm all confused. Are we on the ones at 58 Ash now?
56.
Oh, okay, we're still, okay. All right, tell me when you've moved to the next location.
Okay. This is in front of 56.
Okay,
it's a 5-inch buckthorn.
3-inch.
3-inch. Okay.
And number five is...
Number five.
Number five. 3-inch. And then I'm seeing no objection on that one. And you, Paul, you're going to speak up if you have any serious heart. Okay. Number six is another...
This is a 5-inch.
5-inch buckthorn.
That's a 3-inch.
It's a 3-inch.
Another 3-inch? Okay. It's just, you know, I had put okay by that one for mine from a visual aspect of it. So now we're still at 56, and...
It should be at 58.
Is it 58 at this point? It'd be a...
4-inch.
No, we're talking about a 12-inch sugar maple.
That's a 58.
Which is tree number 7, if you're counting down the list. And that one is one that I put a question of why, because it looked like it was 6 feet off the curb. And it didn't look all that bad.
6 feet off the edge of pavement, Mr.
Yeah. Chairman?
So we're going with a 5.5-foot wide sidewalk?
Well, it was my arm span plus a little bit more. I mean, I think, Elaine, I might have a picture of that one.
These are your photos.
Okay. It was not this dead. No. Yep. It was this one here.
Oh, it's not that one.
No, it's not one.
Give me these back yet.
It didn't have the blades.
Yeah, again, if it's 6 feet or arm's length plus, we're going to be into the root system in the front there. We can attempt to save it. Doesn't look like there's a grading issue there. So we can attempt to save it, but we're going to be all into the root system in the front of that tree.
Recommendation? Worth a try?
Yeah, it's worth an attempt.
Just for clarification, Eric, are you the tree warden?
Yes, sir.
Excellent.
Sorry, Paul Gleason, tree warden.
So we're talking about number 7, the 12-inch sugar maple that's somewhere around number 56.
Yeah. I suppose that's that picture, right?
Yep, that's the picture.
You're suggesting the...
I think they've... Anyone else have any comments on number 7? Frank? Frank, this is one that...
Does he want to see?
Unfortunately, I didn't label him Frank, but it's...
Is he watching something?
It's one that's far away from the street compared to the other ones I showed, which are at the end of driveways. Frank, you there?
Yeah, okay, I follow.
Okay, good.
At the pleasure of the planning board, we can leave it, do our construction, and see what happens here.
Why don't we figure out a condition that allows it to be determined in the field that if you're ruining it, you know, you're going to kill it, go ahead?
Just let me know when you're in that area, and I'll be over.
And we'll put the responsibility on the tree warden as to whether or not the damage is such that it predicts it. So that's number 7. Now we're at number 8. Number 8 going down the list is a
3-inch sugar maple.
3-inch sugar maple, and that's right in the middle of one of the headwalls, I believe. We are right at 56, right in the center of the top piece of his plan. The plan's got two sections of it. We're right in the center, right under the words Ash Street, basically. And there's a 4-inch sugar maple that when you start to redo the drain, I think it's going to be gone for sure. So I'm not seeing any objection to number 8. Number 9 is
4-inch sugar maple.
Another 4-inch sugar maple, kind of on the other side of that drain area, and close to the street, if I remember correctly. I'm not seeing any objection to number 9. Number 10 is a big tree. This is at the end of number 58, I think. I think I took a picture of that one.
Is the resident from number 58 Ash Street here? We met with the resident in the field. He had this with his light on it.
Yep.
We spoke to him. He had no objection to the removal of the tree. He said that it's a sight distance issue for him pulling out anyway. We talked about his light. He said he's happy to relocate the light in the interest of the sidewalk and removing the sight distance hazard.
Can I ask a question about that location? It's a huge tree. It's just such a shame because a 41-inch oak is a pretty old tree, but you're right. It's like right into the road, and it's a sight distance thing. But in that same vicinity, on either side of the tree and all around that tree, there are huge boulders. Mm-hmm. So and those add to the scenic value of the road, too. What's going to happen with those big boulders? Are they going to be able to be moved back onto the property, or?
As we did, through you, Mr. Chairman, as we did on the northerly section that we constructed,
uh-huh.
we're happy to remove those and slide those up onto the property so that they retain the character.
And the property owner is willing to have those moved up?
We'll have that conversation with them. It's the pleasure of the planning board to maintain those boulders.
Well, they just seem to be an integral part of the character of the street, and clearly they have to go because they're right there. But it's a shame to lose them if they can be relocated in the vicinity.
Mm-hmm. Did you have a conversation with the property owner about potentially going around the back of the tree?
We did not, Mr. Chairman. The grades in there are. There's a steep incline behind that, so I don't know if we'd be able to accommodate ADA requirements with going behind that and across. Would also require easements, which we haven't secured, but we can.
Well, the other thing, because I looked at that, is those boulders are on both sides of the tree. So if you tried to go around, you've got a big boulder to deal with, unless they could take the boulder
and without taking out the tree. I think we're saying, and if there's anyone that's objecting to this, please speak up, that this tree is a sacrifice for the sidewalk. Yeah, go ahead, Paul.
Not only are all the roots missing on the Ash Street side of the tree, there is, you can see in the photos, a large seam crack on the driveway side. And if you stand in the driveway and look back to the tree, you'll see it's already starting to rot into the trunk. So this tree is, of all the trees in this discussion, this is actually the most hazardous of the group.
Okay. So it looks like
number 10.
Out. Okay.
Question now, for the chair?
Yeah, go ahead.
Is there value to the selling the tree for raw wood?
I think you're going to find that, with the exception of some of the limbs, that the trunk of that tree is going to be pretty much rot all the way through.
And that's up to John. If he gets a dollar or two and he offloads his budget, he built another foot of sidewalk somewhere.
Well,
I mean,
that Frank's comment occurred to me too when I saw that tree. That when we do have to take down significantly large trees of a wood like an oak or something, if that lumber can be sold, perhaps that those funds could go into the tree fund.
I think you'll find that you will not get very much money at all for the amount of board foot of lumber that you would produce, especially not even knowing going in what you've got. You know, this tree is already, do you have a picture of anything?
Yeah.
Thank you. See this crack running up the side here?
Yeah.
Okay. That's running the entire length of this tree up to where all of the branches break out from. So this entire lower portion is of no value whatsoever.
If you want to split one that big, to me that's getting to be too much work.
At least you don't even know once you get past into the center. You don't even know if you've got only 2 or 3 inches of holding width.
Yeah.
It could be, the whole
thing. Okay, we want to kind of move on a little bit. I think we are on number 11, which is a 18-inch hickory, and this is in front of 60. I think I took a picture of that one. That was another one where I was going to ask you the question whether you could go around it or not.
I marked save on mine as well.
Mr. Chairman, without without an easement, we can't go around it, but we can certainly have a conversation with the abutter to see if they would offer an easement.
Is somebody for 19? Oh.
You're going to need to make your loop way back through here without severely impacting the root system of this tree. So you're going to be somewhere deep onto this person's property.
Is number 60, anyone here from number 60? Well, let's go on to all the rest of them here, and we'll come back to 11. And then we'll think about that while we're going through the rest of them here. I think we're looking at the next tree, which is number 12, which is in the bottom of the middle here of the bottom of the sheet. It is a 16-inch ash that looked like it was almost dead.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. There's two ashes in the middle of the stone wall in front of my house.
Oh, that's your house?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've been trying to get both of them removed for years because one had already fell into the street. I have no objection to the ash.
Okay, so number 12 is almost dead and will be shortly.
The other one was an ash also, but it's a hickory. I don't care if it's in the middle of the wall.
The hickory is further down on the other side of the driveway.
And then that's in front of my neighbors.
Okay,
that's in front of 60.
So let's see. Are we now at the first wall, or do we want to come back to all the walls?
No, we're talking about trees in the walls now, because they're growing in the walls in my, my house. So any ash tree in the wall, I don't have any objection to in front of 64.
Okay. And then this is where we have 40 feet of stone wall, and it's relocate and replace or remove and
remove and relocate.
What's R&R standard for?
Remove and relocate. So what we're proposing there is what we had done before. This is less of a constructed stone wall than a
collection of
pile of rocks. Thank you very much. So we're looking to move that pile of rocks back behind the sidewalk.
That's fine.
Okay with you.
Yeah, as long as it looks good.
Thank you.
Okay, so the same rocks will be reused for that 40-foot area. Okay, the next item that we're looking at is number 13, which is a 14-inch hickory.
That's actually in front of 66. So
that's in 66. Anyone here from 66?
No.
Okay.
Yeah,
go ahead.
I wondered about that 14-inch hickory, if we could make an attempt to save it. It's about 7 feet back from the road. And I know the sidewalk that's already been built is about a 5.5-foot sidewalk that's very close to the, it's right up against Ash Street. So I'm wondering if a tree that's 7 feet back could be saved. And the reason I'd like to see that 14-inch hickory saved is I just want to remark about all these trees along the 64 Ash Street property. The other ones, you're right, the hickory is actually at the driveway of 66. These other ones, the 16-inch ash, which is extremely tall, it doesn't even provide any shade. It's all the leaves are up high, and the other smaller ones. I didn't see the individual trees as issues given the nature of that stretch of roadway, but what I did notice is that entire frontage of 64 Ash Street has been completely stripped of trees on the scenic road in the right-of-way. I saw stumps on the right-of-way side from trees in some years, some didn't look that old, that have already been cut. There's a 24-inch stump there's a 14-inch stump, there's about a 12-inch stump, and about an 18-inch stump of either oak or hickory, some kind of a hardwood tree, all in the town right-of-way that are gone.
They were all ash.
And that, yeah, and that's, and so, you know, that's an entire stretch of the scenic road that's lost. It's bare when you go through this, lost all its trees. And this hickory is the first of the trees in that vicinity that gives a canopy that Ash Street is known for, and it's a huge tree. I don't know how high it is. It's a towering tree. There's a, I don't know whether they're little maples or cherries or something. Right afterwards, it's a small tree that doesn't seem to be in very good health, that doesn't contribute as much. But that 14-inch hickory is the first tree in that area that contributes to the foliage canopy that Ash Street is known for. So I would like to see that kept if we can, because it is 7 feet back.
How close that culvert is?
I guess my
that looks a lot. There's not that much space between where the brook actually wraps around and the culvert goes across. That's my neighbor's property, but his driveway comes out.
I thought on that 14-inch hickory, as much as I like the hickories, that from a visual standpoint, I thought that there was enough behind it at that point where you wouldn't miss it as much.
Well, going in that direction, but the other way, I mean, it's completely open at 64 Ash, so to bring a little more foliage in, it, you know, again, it's a significant, it's a really big, tall tree. And, you know, we do try not to lose our big trees on scenic roads if it can be avoided. And I think the foliage it provides and the canopy contributes to the scenic area, which the scenic nature has been lost along the 64 frontage, so.
Okay. We've lost a lot of ash trees on Ash Street.
Keep going.
And they're dying all the time. Okay, so I'm adding 13 to our potential list to finalize. Number 14 is a 3-inch sugar maple. That's right in the middle of the culvert, I believe. Anyone have any problems with that one? Okay, which is item 13, I think.
That's 14.
14?
Yeah.
And then we got 15, which is a 12-inch
sugar.
And that is right in the middle of the culvert, I believe.
Yep.
So no possibility there. And then there is another 3-inch, number 16, which is where the stone wall is, kind of in that area. If I remember right, that one might have been marked by the utility company too, because they're going through to try to mark the trees too, so all the neighbors will be having a hearing with them sooner than later, I think. NSTARS wants to go after them, or Eversource. Number 17, sugar maple, 3-inch. Not seeing any major objections. There's a number 18 is a 3-inch black cherry. Then we have a 10-inch stone wall. If I remember correctly, this would be at 68, and that was just a kind of a driveway apron wrap around. I mean, a pile of stones about 16-inch softball size.
It returns, basically.
Returns,
right,
yeah.
Yeah.
Moving that out of the way, I'm not hearing any objections. Then we've got a... Where are we? Okay, that's it.
Last one is number 19.
Sure. Number 19, which is a 6-inch black river birch. And it's under the wires, and if I remember correctly, it's doing one of these things because it's been pruned pretty badly.
It's a black birch with bacteria cankers, and it's not long for the world in any case.
So number 19, I'm not hearing any objections. So anyone from the public have anything more to say?
I have one issue. When one of those trees that is now a stump that is beside my driveway and my mailbox was removed several years ago, the rock wall was knocked down, and it was supposed to have been reconstructed. I'm assuming that it'll be reconstructed as part of this because it would be sitting in the sidewalk.
Where is that, sir?
That would be right here. And they would, there's a stump here.
Yeah.
And these rocks were knocked into that area.
So is this a similar construction where it's a pile of rocks?
Well, this is more constructed down to just before the culvert. Mm-hmm. And then after the, in this area from here to here, it is more of a pile of rocks.
Is it a dry construction up here?
Yeah, it's dry construction.
We can certainly restock those, restack those on the,
I think
the wall.
We have to. Yeah. And then down here, there is actually one other tree. It's in the middle of this wall. It is actually half of it had fallen into the street and almost caused an accident. So that also could be taken down.
The tree right beside the driveway?
Yeah, there's a dead tree here and a dead dying tree here. And they're both ash.
It's not this one, is it?
No.
Okay. This one wasn't marked with a white dot, Paul, but
I think this one.
That was. That, I don't know. It looked like it was not long for the world. It looked like it'd be hazardous for us walking under the sidewalk.
That's, I believe that was on private property.
Was it? Okay.
Because yeah, I looked at it. Yeah. Really nothing I could do about it.
Okay.
And both those ash trees are in the middle of the wall, which is actually the lot line.
Question to the chair.
So that's sure.
Isn't that wall, it's a farmer's wall, a stone wall, right?
Yeah. So it's also my boundary line on the deed.
So that's, it's not even part of the project then. That's my point.
No. Well, he's going to reconstruct 40 feet of it.
Half of it's on the wall.
One of those rocks is actually a marker because my lot is not straight.
Like a mile marker?
No, it is a point where the
drill hole.
Yeah, it's a drill hole where the street actually curves at two points. So I have like 20 feet on this side, then it turns, runs for 110 feet, then it turns for another 20 feet, and goes on. So one of those rocks is a drill hole, which is part of the description of my plot line.
Okay, take one of these.
Yeah.
Three, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to offer the property owner to call me tomorrow and I can stop out, take a look at the concern over the tree and the drill hole to make sure that sidewalk isn't going to interfere with the drill hole. If it is, we'll reestablish that.
It's really not our purview, but it's good that we get the communication going. Okay. I think we're down to re-talking about 11 and 13.
Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
I just noticed there is another small section of wall. Thank you, Paul. If you look at the top where Ash Street is, there's a section here, R&R stone wall, that escaped my attention previously.
Okay.
So that's another piece that we want to do the same thing to just move those stones back.
Criteria for this is the impact on the scenic road in terms of public safety, welfare, and convenience, whether there's replacement of trees and walls, ability of reasonable alternatives to the proposed work, which I think we've talked about on all these, whether the proposed work would compromise or harm other environmental or historic valuables, and the consistency of the proposed work with previously adopted town plans and policies. The last time we included a condition for the stones, that stones removed for this project shall be used to build up existing sections of stone wall in the immediate area within the road right away. And I assume that would be a condition that we would include like we did before. And now we're back down to, I think we've said that of the trees, only 11 and 13 require a little bit final discussion. 11 was a...
Mr. Chairman, number 7.
7 as well.
Oh, 7?
Which is a 12-inch sugar maple.
7, 11, and 13.
Right.
No? Did I get the wrong numbers?
13 is correct.
I'm sorry, 11 was one correct. That you were... You're absolutely correct. 11
7,
was the 13.
7, 11, and 13.
7 was the one that Paul was going to look at in the field.
Mm-hmm. Okay, 7 is to look at. So we'd need a condition that... If we decided... If we put all three of these as a... try to save with the tree warden making the final judgment at the time of construction, would that be, Claire, something that you could live with?
Yeah.
Was that a yes?
Yes.
Okay, so 7, 11, and 13 has got that special condition. Having said that, Elaine, we need a motion to approve this with the two conditions we've talked about.
Mr. Chair?
I have a question, too.
I just want clarification. Where the 40 feet of stone wall at 64 Ash, that's being just moved back, right? That's
correct.
Going to be retained. It's just moved back. It's not.
In all instances, we're going to do that, yes.
Just check.
Tremendously large rocks.
Yeah, no, but...
Well, a tremendously large excavator will push them back.
Well,
I'm concerned about. They are very large rocks. I don't want them dropping on my lawn.
Got it.
Need to be controlled.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll work with you. It actually saves the town because then we don't have to pay to dispose of them.
I think all those rocks can be just restructured.
Okay. Any further public comments on this? Seeing none, I'll entertain
I had a question.
Go ahead.
With the proposed stone walls that we talked about earlier,
mm-hmm.
I just want clarification. And it may not be part of this, you know, this discussion, this public hearing. I just want to know, is the plan to revisit the granite wall that was put in front of 54 when
yes.
those are being done?
Yes.
And there's no objection
just
from members here.
For continuation, you know, continuity of the look going down
correct.
The street.
Correct. Three, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
There were two locations where we used the bridge curbing, which is just a taller granite curbing. The location up close to the center of town, there was no objection from the homeowner, but there was down the southerly section. And just for clarification, the retaining walls that we're building at the two culverts, from the street side, you will only see 4 inches behind the sidewalk. If you were to stand in the stream and look at them, then you would see the full height, which
mm-hmm.
will be a field stone, wet construction, mortared construction wall.
So from the street, you'll only see about 4 inches is what you're saying?
Correct.
Okay.
And then on top of that is where we will mount that
wooden rail.
Rail.
I have one other concern, where that dry culvert goes through, right here. This section right here is enormous flat rock that you're going to have to remove if you're going to put any kind of catch drain in here. So this whole area will have to be bridged.
Well, Mr. Chairman, that's why there's a drainage manhole that will go in there, and we've got a similar one that we constructed up on the northerly section where it looks like just a steel grate that is the full width of the sidewalk and about 6 feet wide, and that's got an inlet in the front, and the cover is such that you can lift it and climb down into it as a manhole.
All right, we can talk about that.
Okay.
I just want that as a helping issue.
That's part of the sidewalk, John?
Yes. Again,
the
it was...
The grate will be part of the sidewalk?
It's not a grate. It is a piece of galvanized metal, if you will. It's 5.5 feet wide by probably 6 feet long. And as you're going home tonight, if you look, there's a section up on the northerly piece that we constructed. So it's got a that particular one is a pass-through, so the water can pass through the sidewalk. And this will be a similar thing. There'll be an inlet at the curb, but for the walking surface, it will be that galvanized material.
Entertain a motion to approve the plan with trees 7, 11, and 13, subject to a condition that during construction, the tree warden will determine whether the tree can be saved, and that all the rocks will be reused, et cetera, the wording that we used the last time.
When someone's participating, will we have to have a roll call?
We have to have a roll call vote because Frank is still in China.
Frank, still on?
Yep, okay, great. Do you have any questions over there?
Well, my only question is something that we haven't really talked about, and it's really about the mailbox. I think it increases the likelihood of a maintenance problem, and it results in ugly. Why did we elect to put all of the mailboxes on in the sidewalk as opposed to moving everything to the other side of the road?
Three, Mr. Chairman, when we were discussing mailboxes on that initial piece that we constructed, the abutters didn't want to have to cross the busy street and stand in the pavement when there was the safety of the existing sidewalk for them to be able to access their mailboxes and paper boxes. Additionally, the reason that they are right at the edge of roadway like that, that's a requirement of the U.S. Postal Service that the mail delivery folks, they cannot get out of their trucks and they cannot reach beyond 6 inches beyond the face of the curb.
In regards to that, I now have a question about the winter. Is there room between the stone walls and where the mailboxes are going to be placed to get the town sidewalk snowblower? Because at that section of road, four or five times last year, they had to ride up right onto adjacent to the rock walls to blow the snow away from the street, so there was room to push more snow back onto the sidewalk. Now you're going to have to clear not only the street, but the sidewalk, and dump all that onto all of our properties, and get by the mailboxes that you're going to put in at the same time.
Three, Mr. Chairman, we'll use the same snow removal procedures that we did on the northerly section, where we're able to fit the machine behind the sidewalk, on the sidewalk behind the mailboxes. That's why the mailboxes are turned to be parallel with the curb, because if they were the other way, then we would absolutely be hitting them, but when they're turned parallel, we're able to get through with the machine.
So at this time, I'll entertain a motion to approve with those two conditions.
So moved.
Moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay. Further discussion? I think we're ready for the vote. So this has got to be a roll call vote. Frank, how do you vote?
I vote yes. Affirmative.
Okay. John?
Yes.
Ryan?
Aye.
Ken? Aye. Matt?
Aye.
Aye.
Frank?
Aye. Okay.
Yeah, Claire?
I hate cutting down so many trees. Okay. Aye.
Okay, so the vote is unanimously in favor of it. It's done by a roll call. Thank you very much.
Thank gentlemen. You very much.
Mr. Chairman, may I just ask the tree warden a quick question while he's here? Where we've lost so many ash trees and they're such historic trees for Hopkinton, is there a problem with the ash trees nowadays, or are those trees that maybe as we look to replant, we could try to put in ash trees?
No,
there's no problem. Fair. No, you don't. Is it like a Dutch elm?
No, you have the problem that you have already, which is a disease called ash yellows.
Uh-huh.
That's what's killing them.
Yeah.
There's no cure for that.
Okay.
And we are now on the edge of emerald ash borer, which there's also not a great deal you can do about that. It's going to go through here like wildfire when it does.
All right.
So get a good look at the ash trees now, because you're just about done seeing them.
Put some chestnuts back in place.
Nice American
test? Whatever.
Three, Mr. Chairman, just a point of interest for the planning board and the abutters who are here. We're going to be opening the bids on Monday, the 31st. We will offer a contract to the lowest responsive and responsible bidder, probably within 2 weeks' time thereafter. So look for construction to begin end of September and into October and completing in November.
Done for the winter.
Before the snow ends.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone,
for coming out here. Okay, we're running now a little bit late, but...
Mr. Chair, if I may, thank you for allowing me to participate remotely, but I do have to disconnect at this point.
Okay, Frank, we'll see you, and you'll be able to watch the tape for the library portion, because that'll probably get continued.
That's true, Brian. Okay, thank you. Bye.
Okay.
So it's the library portion, not going to happen tonight?
Yes, yes, it's happening now.
Oh, okay. I'm still here.
Okay, let's get kind of reset up here.
There's a ton of people out there, I don't know. Are we going to move to the Selectmen's, or is that the town?
Is Mark home in there, or is there...
There's nobody in there. Let's see if we can get some more chairs in here then, I guess.
Okay.
We're a popular group today, huh?
I'm not sure where we want to set up the board.
Behind the lanes?
Stand on this table.
Yeah.
Hi, Ron. Good to see you.
Sir, how are you?
Go early, go often.
Yeah, every day. Looking for your car in the parking lot. How the hell is Rusty?
See, we maybe grab a few more chairs from the adjoining room.
Good thing is if you get...
This is the place to be.
So we can take this one. Yeah, I've only got a bit of time to play it. It's even better.
Where's the popular kids?
Okay.
Need a bigger town hall.
Well, we're about to get a big meeting room across the street, I think.
Oh, really? No. Good point. Oh, yes.
If you're part of the project, take a seat up at the table, or we can get rid of a couple of chairs at the table too to try to make it a little bit easier. Hi, Ben.
Hey, I'm just here for the intro, then we'll leave.
Okay. At this point, I think I'll open the public hearing. This is for the library for 13 Main Street and 9 Church Street. Site plan review and a shared off-site parking special permit application. The applicant is the town of Hopkinton. This is proposed building additions and site improvements with in connection with the public library renovation expansion project. The proposed shared parking be located at 14 Main Street and 18 Main Street. As we've got a full house today, as the custom of the planning board, we prepared a public hearing outline for the project. We have plenty of time during the meeting for public comment and input. I don't know if there's any extra of these. If there were, they've been probably taken.
Is it online?
It is online, I believe, with the outline. But let's make sure, Elaine, that there's one at least for Dan and crowd over here. We traditionally start with a project introduction and review by the applicant, and we'll have comments from our Director of Land Use Planning and Permitting. Consultant Beta Group is here. They'll touch on the highlights. And then we will go to the point where we add to the outline. And the custom of the planning board is to, at this point, is just to add to the outline. And then we're going to go through the outline point by point and try to get a consensus on that. Maybe it's a consensus with some action items for a follow-on meeting. But to try to get through things and check them off if we've got to the point where we're done. Then at the end of that conclusion, we'll talk about the site plan standards and any plan revisions that are being made, conditions of approval. There is another opportunity at the end for public comment again. But during this outline discussions, I encourage the public to talk about the item that we're talking about. If we're talking about signage or building or site lighting, that's what we want to focus on at that point. That kind of focuses everyone's attention on that. And then we'll take the votes and close the public. Elaine, I forgot to close the public hearing on the tree warden thing, so I'm looking for a motion to close the public hearing on the tree warden.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and second. And further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Now I guess I got it right. Okay. So let's start with the project introduction and review. Ben or Dan?
Real quick. Dan McIntyre, Chairman of the Permanent Building Committee. I really don't have any prepared remarks, but I just want to introduce the team real quick. Jim DeVillis is our civil engineer. Ron Mueller, a traffic engineer. Stuart Roberts is our architect. Jim's probably going to do most of the presentation tonight. But with that, I want to turn it over to Ben, Chairman of the Board of Selectmen, for just a couple of words on behalf of the town.
Okay. So thank you all. It's very exciting to actually be here in what will hopefully be close to at least the last step of this whole process of getting approvals done. I am here to speak tonight on behalf of the applicant, which is the town of Hopkinton, and I just want to make 2 points. First of all, as you all know, this is a project that is overwhelmingly supported by the community. It's passed 3 votes, 2 at town meeting overwhelmingly, and once the polls, 2-1. So this is something the community very much wants. And the approval has been for this project in this location. I know that you all have a phenomenally methodical process, and Mr. Chairman, I give you great credit for this design and this outline that directs things. The only request would be obviously that we try to move forward through this as efficiently as we can, because we do have some timing issues but we need to get sort of stay on in order to keep this project moving forward as we'd like. So I have no fear, however, you will move this forward expeditiously. The only other comment I want to make is about something that's on here tangentially, which is parking. And this is sort of the great elephant in the room for any project, I think, downtown nowadays. We have a good problem, which is a lack of parking downtown for all the businesses and all the other activities that are ongoing here. And I think it's well recognized at this point. I think it's becoming severe quickly. Again, I think this is a positive development because it just points to the fact that we have a lot of good businesses setting up downtown and things coming and people wanting to be here. This library is obviously going to add substantially to the need for parking downtown. The plan as designed meets the requirements in the bylaws for parking spaces. So in the narrow sense, I'm utterly confident that what they have put together here is a project that is fit in all regards for approval with regard to the parking portion. But we all know, in the larger sense, we have to fix the parking issues downtown. This is something that I personally have worked on for almost the entire 5 years I've been the Board of Selectmen so far. We'll continue to work on it. We have to do something about that. And so the only request I would make is that we not conflate the larger issues of downtown needing more parking with this project specifically. We are going to have to address that. I think there are a number of ways we are trying to address that. But unfortunately, it's not going to necessarily be done in advance of getting this project completed. So I'm always obviously happy to answer any questions you have about that or anything else. If there's anything else we can do in the Board of Selectmen to help, let me know. But with that, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I look forward to a good hearing. I'm going to step aside now and let Dan and his crew take over and get this underway. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. So with that, Jim, can you just kind of take us through the site plan?
Sure.
Get some of the highlights.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. My name is Jim DeVellis. I'm a professional civil engineer. My firm is DeVellis Serene. With me tonight is Catherine Martin, who's our registered landscape architect. So we're here on behalf of the town, hired through the town, to provide site plan, civil engineering, and landscape architecture. So I just briefly looked at your outline. What I'd like to do, if it's okay with the board, I have the set of site plans that we submitted. I'll walk you through the layout, materials, grading, drainage, mm-hmm. utilities, and I think everything's covered on this. It might not be in the exact order, but...
Go ahead. Okay. You get the general overview, okay. And we'll talk about Perfect. It in detail later.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're still on step one. You're step one.
Yeah. All right, so in the submission materials was a full set of site plans as well as a full drainage report. So I'm sure I'm going to offend somebody in this room by saying, I'm going to play sit. How's this? Can you guys all see that? So basically a bird's eye view. This is a survey that was given to us. I think the town prepared this with one of the consultants. So basically Main Street and Church Street, the existing library here sits on a 0.13 acre parcel. Associated with the project is this parcel. And that was a white single family home with a garage in the back. So we'll start from this end. The driveway to go to the garage. The house, gravel driveway, supported by water and sewer, some electric lines. On this parcel, we've got the existing library, the parking area, access, dumpster back here, bike rack. As you come around here, you've got the main entrance, the steps, and as you come to the front, there's a flagpole, and then the abutting property on this side, the driveway. So this dark line is the property line. So from the existing conditions survey, again from a bird's eye view, the property line is here, so these are the two parcels. The existing library is here, and the expansion to the library is on this side, so here's your library in the future. The parking is basically going to be over where the existing home site is, over here. And we've got 9 spaces and 11 spaces, so 20 parking spaces. So again, from this side over, we've got a landscape buffer, parking, dumpster, which is closed, curbing, sidewalk, building, sidewalk improvements along here. Here's the entrance, so from the parking, you come down to the walkway and enter that way. Continue on the sidewalk, come to the front. These stairs, there's an entrance here, an entrance here, and an entrance here. The challenge on this site is we've got about a 6.5 foot grade change from finished floor to the sidewalk. So to get handicapped accessible pedestrian access, we've got to allow someone to walk through the doors without steps. So this plane here is in process, right? So it's still developing, and I think next time we'll come back, we'll have a new version of this. But as some able body can walk up the steps, we're providing handicapped accessibility to come to all the doors this way. So no ramps, no steps. And I know there's a little bit of a history with the Historic District Commission on that, the views of that, and the walls and the railing. So we've got some work to do on that. So that's from a bird's eye view looking down.
from the kind of below grade, grade stuff that you don't see on top. He's grading the utility pole. So where we're increasing the amount of impervious surface, with parking and building, we've got to take the stormwater and recharge it into the ground. We've got to detain it. And so we did a drainage analysis that basically the water's coming down to the catch basins here. We did a pre-analysis. We did a post-analysis. And what we're doing is we're capturing the roof runoff and the parking. We did some test pits out here, and that was supplemented with some earlier borings. So this area right here collects the stormwater, puts it in stones, puts it in perforated pipes and stones. The water comes in fast, goes out slow. It's cleaned through storm scepters, catch basins with hoods, and brought out to the drainage system on Church Street, which comes down in this area. More utilities. We've got a sewer line that's going to come out this way to the road. We've got new water lines, domestic and fire. There's a fire hydrant out here, so all of the utilities that are going to service the building, water and sewer, are going to come out in this direction. Landscaping. The next plan is we looked at the zoning requirements with respect to setbacks, landscaping buffers. So again, this area is working here, but these are all going to be low shrubs with some ornamental trees. Still working in that area. There's a tree here that is saved, that we're going to save. There's a couple of street trees along here that they're not substantial, but we're going to maintain and preserve those. As you come back here, there's a 5-foot landscape buffer back here, and starts with 5 feet and goes to about 9 feet down here. So again, we'll start on this area and work this way. There's a buffer on this property over here. It's kind of, what's up there?
Volunteer growth.
Volunteer growth.
It's scrub brush.
We're not touching any of that. This line here is the existing driveway. So we're pulling the driveway back and putting a landscape buffer with lilies, small shrubs, and
honey locusts.
I should let you talk about this part. On the back side, there's an existing 6-foot fence, which is off the property that's staying. A couple small changes from the plans that we submitted. This tree right here is a very small tree. It was my mistake. It's actually a stump, and I thought it was a substantial tree, so that tree is not even there. This tree here, we were looking to protect it, but in further evaluation by the town hall, tree warden, basically saying to have this tree that's kind of over the building, with the building going in, the recommendation is to remove that tree. This tree here, our design has supplemental landscaping around it with this fence, and the tree warden says basically give that a shot because that tree is substantial, it's worth saving, we'll monitor it. So that was our design. Reason that we're, there's a fence existing here. These are going to go in, these are arborvitaes, probably six, seven feet to grow over time higher. So any lights from the parking and the screen here with the fence, with the supplemental, same thing over on that side. And then the rest of the sheets are pretty much standard detail sheets for the utilities. And there's a photometrics plan that was provided by the electrical engineer that provides photometrics for two kind of gooseneck shaped lantern lights, 12, 15 feet up in this area, and we've got some lights up here. So really focused on this walkway and the parking a little more, and then the average foot candle is probably about 0.75, so it's modest over here, and they're shielded so it's not Walmart parking lots and nothing up in past property lines.
We also have two lights on the building, same type of designs on the back of the building.
On this here. On this side. But Katie, I probably stole your thunder. Is there anything you want to add on
the
design? So again, we did submit the plans and the drainage report. We did receive comments from Beta, who's a town's consultant. I had an opportunity to review those. There's nothing in those comments that we can't address. Some they want more details and some different evaluations, but for the most part, there were no surprises on that. And easily accommodated on a plan.
The board would prefer, particularly on the stormwater, that if you work directly with Beta,
sure.
And if they give you a clean letter, our discussion gets to be very short at the meeting on that subject. I mean, you know, and please talk back and forth, and if you can't come to a resolution, then you come back to us, and unfortunately, we play Solomon. We know him better than you, so.
Oh, is Beta here?
Yes.
I'm pretty sure we can come to a resolution on these comments.
Yeah.
So we'll thank you.
I don't think there was anything in there. There was
we'll
too much.
Do that.
Yeah.
So I'd be happy to answer questions if there's anything you want to expand on.
Any
clarification? Yeah. Did I hear that there was a report from Beta in response to your?
It was in on your table this morning. Or this afternoon.
Oh, that's always the answer. It's all right.
Yeah,
it came in last Wednesday or Thursday or something.
It was attached to what I emailed on Friday.
Okay.
It's there on the.
Okay, so more of introduction?
Not a heck of a lot. I just want to mention the landscaping.
I'm sorry, we did prepare this. This might be easier to speak to. Black and white, but basically putting the color on the site plan, so it's a nice, easy presentation to discuss.
Right. We spent about the last year trying to refine this plan, and we've been keeping the abutters involved along the way. And I think their involvement and their questioning, pretty much everything we've done has improved the plan considerably. As far as that tree goes, there's actually two trees out there. The one that needs to come down is really affected by the construction. We can't dig that foundation and really save that tree. But the one close to the property line, we really do want to try to save that. We did commit to the abutters that we would try to save it, and we would like to do that, and then do the supplemental plantings on either side. So that's my only comment to that. And I think there were some comments from Design Review Board on the lighting. They asked us to see if we could reduce the intensity a bit, and that's still in the works. Let's see if we get the answer to that. Did you have anything to add, Stuart? I think we're pretty good. I think to turn it over to questions and comments now.
Well, at this point, if you're done with the application, next on the agenda is hearing from Elaine.
You already mentioned the design review board comments, so those are all set. The other thing was, I just wanted to indicate that the project does meet all the setbacks and zoning requirements as far as dimensional requirements. There aren't any issues there.
Okay.
And Phil will talk about the project.
Okay, so Elaine is fast. Okay. Phil, Beta, give us a summary and then.
Yeah, just a quick note. My name is Phil Paradis. I'm a professional engineer with Beta Group. With me tonight is my colleague Mike Wazowski, traffic engineer with Beta Group as well. Mike is also familiar with the Main Street project and all the traffic that goes on there, so he fits well that he's able to speak to the project tonight. As was indicated by Mr. Davilis, many of our comments are technical in nature, administrative. So obviously not going to go through all of them. There are a few that we just wanted to point out. We enjoy the landscape plan. I think, however, it's going to need to be some coordination with snow storage in the parking lot area. Wasn't clear whether the existing sign was going to remain or it was going to be changed out or
relocated someplace in the front.
Okay. We just want to make sure for landscaping that the screening was actually met the 5-foot height. As relates to, and then we had a number of landscape recommendations, comments, but we won't go into detail for those. As it relates to stormwater management, again, a lot of are technical in nature and are in accordance with the standards of the town. But there were three that I just wanted to point out. One is the town utilizes the Cornell rainfall data that should be analyzed. A second was that NRCS indicates this area is, the soils are rated in the hydraulic soil group rating of D, which is poorly draining, which is good and bad. One is that the difference between a developed site and an undeveloped site is less, but also there's probably a restriction in terms of how much you can infiltrate in the project. A D rating soils indicates that the developer just has to infiltrate to the maximum extent practical. So we'll have to work together on that one. And then I think there was some borings provided, but no soil test data.
Yeah, we started our design with the borings, and they went down 15, 20 feet. And then the town supplied the backhoe. So we actually, I'm a soil evaluator. I did the soil evaluations, so I'll include that in the report.
Excellent. And then obviously the big issue is the parking. And I think there's going to be obviously some discussion. We went through the numbers, basically from what we could ascertain. There was two different ways to do it, and we, from the square footage of the building minus the assembly area, required 32 parking spaces. The assembly area itself plus the staff required 62, so it was a net of 94 required based on the zoning for this project. However, it is in the downtown parking district.
Downtown business district.
Right, and so that cuts it in half. So that 47, they provided 20 on site. It looks like they're showing four spaces. I don't know if they can really get four in the handicap ramp there. But I think there's some discussion about getting shared parking with an adjacent church as well. So I think that has to be vetted through this process in terms of. And then the last, I want to leave the traffic comments to Mike.
Sure. Thanks, Phil. I think just a couple of quick things. One of the recommendations was to change the flow of traffic on Church Street from what is two-way today to one-way away from Main Street. We would request or recommend that additional study be done on Price Street, Maple Price, and then Grove Street be added to the traffic analysis, as those streets would be where the Church Street traffic would be outletting to. They would be coming down Church Street using Price Street to get over to Hayden Row Street. There was a small street, Church Place, I believe it was, that is narrow in cross-section. So we have some concerns with traffic using those roadways.
You mean Price Street?
Price Street.
Price Street, yes. That's the narrow. There was just a couple consistency things between some of the data in the tables and the turning movement counts. So just recommend taking a look at those and revising as necessary. I think that was the majority of the comments that we had. When you do start to move traffic onto Hayden Row Street, with the increase of traffic on Main Street, you end up with some sizable queues and extensive delays. So, we just encourage, some coordination on that as the project moves forward.
Mike, I think one of the other comments you had was possibly extending the one-way all the way to Maple Street?
Yeah, that's correct. If one way is desirable, you know, at the north end of the street, you might consider it all the way down. And that's where the interaction with Maple and the other streets comes into play.
Just to be clear, this project isn't proposing changing Church Street into a one-way.
Is not, or is?
Is not. We think, you know, that came up in the traffic report, but we think that needs a broader consensus of the entire town than one particular project. So we're not proposing that. We're proposing to keep it as two-way. If the town thinks it would be an improvement, then that can be done at a later date, but we don't think it should be a library issue to change the street from a one-way to a one-way.
Well, the town pays for it one way or the other, so it doesn't matter from a cost standpoint, but, you know, I'm not sure the traffic works really well without it. I mean, I've read Ron's report, something similar to what this board looked at when we had discussions on Walcott Street and the development there. It's almost the same argument that we had, and I know we, as a board, have sent something to a letter to the Selectmen saying that seriously ought to be done. But we'll talk a lot about that.
And that's where it belongs, at the Selectmen, not at the library.
Well, we're going to have to determine to make a parking area that works in one way or the other. We'll make a recommendation. Okay. Okay, so that, Phil, you guys are done with your overview?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, now we're at the point where planning board members and the public can add to our outline. Between what I read this afternoon and looking at the outline and what I just heard, I'll start it off by adding a couple items. For item E, the site lighting, let's add flagpole lighting. I believe that was a design review comment somewhere. And also hours for the lighting, just to make sure we talk about that. Something I heard tonight would be adding to the list would be snow storage, handicap access ramp, and a bike rack. And I think we had missed all of those in our initial outline. And these are just subjects that we'll talk about in great detail on the outline to get through the approval process. Any other planning board members have anything else you want to add to the outline? Anyone
Mr.
from the
chair?
Yeah,
hours of activities. So that's out of the standard hours of operations. Hours of any activities that are being held.
Okay. That on a lot of the commercial projects, so it's similar to that. Okay, other questions adding on to the outline by members of the planning board?
I do, and I know it may sound kind of repetitive, but we have public comment as number 8. I would like to have maybe direct comment by abutters be more highlighted in earlier in the discussion.
The abutters always get preference, but yeah, in public. I mean, when we talk about all the detailed discussions, the butters are always more than welcome to be in.
Okay, so if there's specific points, they could ask a question at that
sure.
time?
Sure, okay. Yes. As we go down the outline, we want to encourage people that want to talk about a bike rack or whatever it is to talk about it at that point, and then we'll kind of hopefully narrow the list down as we go through the public hearing process. Other comments or additions to the outline by members of the public? We had a pretty comprehensive list, and I wish we had more copies of it today, but... right now the list is traffic flow and Church Street one-way, pedestrian traffic flow, outside or curb book return, parking on-street, off-street, on-site, site lighting, flagpole lighting, hours for lighting, building design, signage, landscaping, neighbor buffers and existing trees, stormwater management, utilities, zoning compliance, combining the lots, schedule and construction conditions, dumpster hours and screening, hours of activities, snow storage, handicap access ramp, and a bike rack. And that's what I've got on the list. Seeing no additions, we've got a comprehensive list, I think, for this plan. So let's start right into that. And the first one is traffic flow in the Church Street one-way is the first on the list.
I have a comment.
You can. I mean, it's an open kind of discussion. I was going to ask Ron to kind of present his findings from the traffic engineer.
Sure.
Okay.
Thank you. For the record, Ron Villa, just professional traffic engineer. The study that I prepared for this project follows all the normal standards of traffic impact analysis, evaluating existing conditions, projecting what future traffic will be like in this area, and then adding development traffic in the library and what impact that has. In addition to that, as Beta had mentioned, it evaluated separately what if we made Church Street one way and how would that work with and without the project. One of the things, currently traffic operations are acceptable for the most part. I'll take a few exceptions to that. Traffic turning out of Church Street onto Main Street does operate poorly today. It does still have capacity to do so. And the same thing happens at Hayden Row Street. You take a left turn from Hayden Row Street onto Main Street. Very tough movement to make. A lot of delays during peak hours. The growth in traffic that we have here in town, I have included 12 other development projects in my traffic projections, not the least of which is Legacy Farms, and we all know that adds a tremendous amount of traffic to the downtown area. But in addition to that, we have the Hopkinton Use Project, Lumber Street Mixed-Use Project, the Starbucks and retail development at the corner of Lumber and West Main Street Residential Project, near Wayland Road, Mastinock Woods, Dunkin' Donuts, Main Street Mixed-Use Development, Ashland Woods, and now these are all the projects in Hopkinton, and then there's four more in Ashland. Ashland Woods, this is the apartment building that's recently been constructed, the nursing home that's still under construction, the West Union Street apartments, and Ashland MBTA station phase one, which consists of 500 condos near the MBTA station. So the sum and substance of all that is a tremendous amount of growth in traffic that we can expect over the next 7 years, which is the timeline that I chose for this study, because that's what the standard is for traffic impact assessments. What that will do ultimately is cause a problem at the Hayden Row Street and Main Street intersection. Without a doubt, there's very long delays. Mike from Beta mentioned it before that the delays are significant in the matter of in terms of minutes of delay. It is difficult to once. You're so far over capacity, the delay values don't really mean anything anymore, so you can't really say the project will add whatever 60 seconds of delay. It's really not an appropriate measure anymore at that point. But what it is, that we're going to have a problem with that location. And the same thing would be true at Church Street if we don't make any changes to it. Church Street does have somewhat of a unique opportunity, different from Walcott Street, in that if we change it to one way southbound away from Main Street, from there up to Church Place, anybody heading north on the remaining section of Church Street comes to that one way, sees do not enter signs, and then is forced to take a right up to Church Place. So they have an outlet that gets them back to the public street system. Different from Walcott Street. You approach Walcott Street, you have no choice but to turn around and go back to where you came. Claflin Street is a dead end. So I think that presents somewhat of a unique opportunity that we might want to take advantage of. Whether it's as part of this project or independent of this project, I think the traffic analysis that's included in the report, both with and without that one-way change, shows that the library project in and of itself doesn't have much of an impact on Church Street or its intersections surrounding that. So the biggest focus of this traffic study really is whether or not this one-way change should happen. Right now, Church Street is about 24 feet wide. Parking is allowed on both sides of the street, and it's a two-way street, so something's got to give. That doesn't work. The math doesn't work. So right now, the only saving grace is that there is very little traffic on Church Street. So if you have two-way traffic with parking, somebody has to pull over, wait for the other car to pass. Not that big of a deal. If we do make it one-way, I definitely recommend that it be in the southbound direction for two reasons. One, somewhere between 60 and 75% of the traffic right now goes south. So the balance wouldn't be that much traffic to be inconvenienced by that one-way change. The other reason is for reasons of on-street parking, so that you can create an 8-foot-wide parking lane and a 16-foot-wide travel lane. You could stagger that parking so that to try to reduce speeds. If you recall, when we did the 42 Main Street project, I had suggested that as well. So you start maybe with parking on the west side, and halfway down you go with parking on the east side, so that through traffic actually has to make a little bit of a zigzag move. That is sort of a traffic calming feature, has a tendency to reduce the travel speeds. But there's a number of options available that we can discuss. From a signing perspective, I think it is easily done to change that. It wouldn't take road construction to do that. It's really a matter of siding and striping to change that. So it's a relatively cheap way to solve an existing problem, or a problem that will be a problem. As far as Beta's comments about possibly extending it all the way to Maple Street, I thought about that, and I don't think it's necessary, because whenever you create a one-way street, you're going to inconvenience some people. There's several businesses and residents on that section of Church Street between Main Street and Church Place that will be obviously inconvenienced by this change. But the rest of the road, you have the church and then the rest of the village is all residential. I don't think that we need to inconvenience those people as well by that one-way change. And I also therefore don't think that studying additional intersections really is necessary. When you look at the change in volume, we're talking somewhere between 36 and 42 additional cars that are going to travel on Church Street because of this one-way change. Those cars, you know, this is a peak hour, so those cars aren't really going to have much of an impact regardless of which route they take. You probably don't want to send them down Price Street, I agree with that, because it is a very narrow street, and we could probably, the signs I think that you had recommended, no through traffic, I think that makes an awful lot of sense. Send them down to Maple Street and have them go in either direction on Maple Street, either to Grove or to Hayden Road. I think that is pretty much it. So, again, the change in traffic flow on Church Street is one that I think we all have to have a consensus on, whether we want to do that. And it, as Dan had said, it is independent of the church, of the library project, because it can happen at any time. You can put up those signs and the striping tomorrow and have that change take effect, and it'll be a good thing for the town, with or without this library expansion. So that's it for Mike, unless you have any questions.
Mike? Oh, just a second. Mike, did you have any comments, rebuttals, what you heard from where we're at?
I agree with most of what was said, that, you know, looking at the larger picture, the library project of itself is not really detrimental to the traffic operations in the area. like it was stated, you know, you're adding 40 trips or 45 trips during the peak hour, which is about one every 2.5 minutes on average. But when you consider the Church Street one way, that does start to, you know, make more ripples, you know, going out from the project area. I think part of how those two intersections on Main Street operate today is that there's a lot of courtesy that goes on. If there's queues on Main Street that are backing up and someone wants to make a turn into that traffic, people will allow vehicles to come in. That doesn't get reflected in the traffic analysis, but you know that's an inconsistent event. You know, sometimes you're able to get in, sometimes you're not. But you know, in either case, I don't think the additional trips to the library would change operations very much on either Church Street or on Hayden Road Street.
Okay, now we'll go members of the planning board.
Thank you.
Frank?
Question, Mr. Mueller. You list for Main Street and Church Street, there were four accidents over this 3-4 year period. So it's a 1.3 accidents per year at the Main Street, Church Street intersection.
Yep.
Do you know if those accidents were people coming out of Church Street or into Church Street?
I don't know the specifics on that. Basically, I use the MassDOT database, which is all the accidents that are recorded to the registry. These get compiled, and they do break down whether it was a rear-end accident or an angle collision. I mean, you can see here, the three of those four accidents, total accidents, were rear-end, and one was a turning movement, a cross-movement type accident. So I can't tell you specifically which direction they were traveling, but rear-end collisions presumably on Main Street. Just
happened to be at Church Street.
Yes, at Church. At that.
That's right where the light is. So right. I'm looking to point at Amatino, who was very instrumental in getting us that light for safety, which yep. I think has been very effective. I'd be against making any changes, as McIntyre said, based on this project. It may be something we should look at in the future, but the reasons I'm against it are you're suggesting taking traffic going one way out from Church Street to Main Street, where there is 1.3 accidents per year, and circulating them over to Hayden Row at Main Street, where there is 2.3 accidents per year, which seems a little bit adding to that, taking away from one, adding danger to another. Plus the businesses that are on Church Street, funeral homes, traffic maybe more in the evening that will need to be coming both ways up and down Church Street. And there's doctor's offices that have exits on Church Street that also have a driveway that go off to Main Street that people don't want to do that because of the traffic, so they'll take the back exit and take Main Street west from that intersection instead of coming out of the driveway on Main Street. So I'd be against making any change to Church Street at this time.
Just, Mr. Chairman, if I may.
No, go ahead.
You're correct when you say that if we make Church Street one way away from Main Street, it will add some additional traffic to the Hayden Row Street intersection, without a doubt. Because instead of going down Church Street to get to the business of your home, you now have to take either Grove Street or Hayden Row Street and now come in from that direction. So will that increase accident incidents? I don't know. It will make that existing problem slightly worse, without a doubt. I believe that there needs to be something done down the road at the Hayden Row Street and Main Street intersection, be it a traffic signal, be it some sort of other traffic control that we could introduce.
Is your data current? Because we did a lane change and we changed the approach on that.
It is.
Is the accident less or more since we did the work last, I think it was
that's
summer?
That's a good point.
And we added a stop sign.
We added a stop sign and we...
And the two-lane approach, right. Yeah, no, these data are through through 2012, which was the most recent available data at the time. So those changes were not in place in 2012.
So we might, you might be comparing apples and oranges on, right, on that area. I know if I'm going to that area, I'll try to take the right. You know, I'm approaching from the east side. I will take Maple Street over, go down Grove Street, and then obviously take the right to get into the library if I'm going into that part of Church Street or whatever. Today I went to go look at trees in the back of the property, and I dodged three people going down a very narrow Church Street to get from basically Maple Street to the library, where we were just, you know,
jockeying for position.
We, you know, there was one lane, and two of us were going for it. So it was three of us just under, say, today's conditions. And then when I got out of it, after I got done looking around, I thought I'd try to do a left turn out of Church Street at about 2:45, 3 o'clock. That didn't work too well. I sat through four series of lights. I could see them coming up at me. People weren't being courteous going westbound, I guess. What? And I'm older, too. Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I was hesitant, but I didn't, you know. So I ended up going right and, you know, going down around the Doughboy and turning around and getting back out. But I mean, you just, I think going, you know, going northbound on Church Street is just a recipe for disaster. And I think we can use this as an opportunity to fix the problem. But Claire, go ahead.
Yeah, well, I agree with Dan that I would rather see this discussed as a separate issue from the library, because I think this needs a full and fair vetting with all the neighbors that are impacted, that go well beyond the library project. And I am concerned that often when we start messing around with make this one way or, you know, do this, do that to the streets, it's more with the focus of what is going to benefit the project under discussion best. Whereas we need to take a holistic approach of looking at the entire neighborhood and not only the project that's under consideration, but its impact for all the residences and the neighbors that are impacted by this. And as soon as you start funneling traffic through these neighborhoods, it has an impact. Right now, the way the traffic is building up at that Hayden Row Street intersection, much of that south side of town, really from Hayden Row Street going south, you feel trapped from about 3 o'clock on, whether it's trying to get in at Ash Street or Hayden Row or Pleasant Street. You cannot, from that entire south side of town, get into the major arteries reliably. And, for instance, people won't be able, from that side, won't be able to get to the library at certain hours if they can't come down Church Street. The only way would be Hayden Row, or to go through the lights at 85, which are already backed up. A whole half of the town will have difficulty late afternoons, after school hours, getting to the library. They can't go down Church Street. So it has a ripple effect. It has a lot of effects on other neighborhoods beyond just what benefits the library best. And I really think that all the neighborhoods involved need fair consideration, which should be done thoroughly and therefore outside of this project. I'd like to just see how the library works without going into the neighborhoods and impacting them.
Yeah, I mean, I'm open to, you know, discussing the one way, both just to, you know, Price Street, you know, or extending it to Maple. You know, I agree with Claire, there would have to be, you know, more town input for that. Also, I don't know, I was just thinking, you know, what if we restricted a left-hand turn on Church? You know, from my point of view, it's always pretty easy taking a right there, to get out. It's the left that, you know, you got a line of sight issue and, you know, other traffic coming the other way. So maybe restricting it to right turn only. But I also agree, you know, part and parcel, this doesn't need to be specific to the library project. It should be looked at a broader scope.
Okay.
I guess my question is, do we have any kind of projection as to what the traffic increase on Church is going to be after the library's expanded?
Yes.
I missed that. I apologize.
I didn't address it, so no need to apologize. On Church Street?
Yes.
On Church Street, south of Church Place, and we're talking not making any changes to the one-way streets. You're talking an increase of 2 to 3 cars during the peaks. On Hayden Row Street, about 4 cars. This is table 5 in the report, so I don't know if you have that in front of you. Church Place, about 4 cars. Majority of the increase, obviously, is going to be on Main Street, because right. That's where most of the Main Street, we're talking about 80 cars to the west of Church Street, and about 35 cars to the east of Hayden Row Street.
And the peak is?
These are the weekday afternoon rush hour and a Saturday midday time period. In the morning, there's virtually there's very little traffic generated by the library, as you can imagine. So really, the peak times are afternoon rush hour traffic and a Saturday midday.
If I could just say, Ronak, the library hours are?
Library hours are Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 10 to 8, Tuesday, Thursday, 10 to 5.
Okay.
Saturdays, 10 to 4. I'm sorry, did I say 9 to 5? I apologize. So let me repeat that. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 10 a.m. to 9 p.m.
Okay.
So you can see all this data part of my information. And Tuesday, Thursdays, 10 to 5 p.m. Okay. And on Saturdays, from September to June, 10 to 4 p.m.
Thank you. All right, so thank you. It is a town-wide issue. It really is. I believe it's a town-wide issue and should not be linked solely to the library. Okay. I think that something does need to be done. Like Matt said, maybe restricting a left turn lane out of Church, if not turning it into a one-way. But I think it is a town-wide issue. It needs a broader discussion.
Ken. What's the plan for Main Street agenda? That is saying that Main Street, which is, we all know, will have the highest impact of traffic. What's the plan for traffic flow improvements in general? Is there anything that implemented or?
Yep.
I mean, it seems like this is like an ongoing prehistoric.
Well, let's see if there's somebody fish. From town engineers still, David.
I'm not hiding that. Yeah. No, there's a much larger downtown corridor project that's been under design since 2010. It's currently funded by the state in 2019 funded project, but it's still in the state Massachusetts Department of Transportation review process.
Mm-hmm. What about the Conway School design? What was that?
Portions of that design, I'm sure, you know, they're parallel with what the 2010-11.
Okay.
So.
Did we kind of answer the question?
Yeah. I'm sorry.
I mean, it's perking along, but it's going along at the pace of state government.
Yeah. Okay.
So. John.
I agree. I think that it's a larger project, and I think what also has to factor into it is as we look at potentially the ongoing discussion of expanding the parking behind here and how that would impact the traffic going on Main Street. So I think we kind of need the broad picture of what potentially is going to happen there. There's so much going on, and I don't want to leave parts and pieces out without knowing what the implication is.
Okay. Okay. Oh, anyone else from the public wants to talk about potentially traffic flow and yes, ma'am.
This is Dan Latina. I just have a couple of things. One is the idea of the no left turn would be just a great improvement tomorrow, even if it wasn't part of the library plan or whatever. And you're absolutely right. The only way to get out of Hayden Row and Church is to just do the Boston block. You pull out, you stop traffic until something, you know, going west eastbound until somebody westbound lets you slide in. That's the only way to do it. I mean, I've stopped using those completely and always go to 85 to the light because even though it's backed up, you still have a chance of getting out without getting killed. That's my whole. And the other thing is parking on Church Street is really your description kind of what you went through today is, you know, that's just common. What happens to, it doesn't make any rhyme or reason, the parking on this end of Church Street. It's people are parked crazy. People come around the corner fast, taking a right turn for Main Street. They barrel up. They don't stop for the cars that are parked on the right side. So I'm wondering, in the parking, the new parking for the library, are they counting spots on Church Street itself in the overall plan? The existing parking spots.
The parking bylaw does not include those as spaces.
Towards the spacing requirement. So there is, it could be a possibility that those parking spots could be removed on the side of the
highway. Would you comment on on-street parking as part of our requirement?
It's on the opposite side of the library, so they're not counted in the library.
Oh, because they're on the opposite side.
The restaurant, however, may be counted.
Right, they are counted for the restaurant.
It's counted for the restaurant.
Yeah. Okay, I've got a couple more questions on this one. Is Church Street as wide as it can be? It seems that way to me, but I'm not. I haven't done a plot layout.
I think it is pretty close to being as wide as it can. It looks like there's a little space between the outside edge of the sidewalk and the property line on the library side, but there won't be when we're done. We're taking that sidewalk up, so yeah, I think we're at the widest.
So basically, widening the pavement to try to make you get through there without blocking people is not a really option.
No.
Okay. Let's try to do one more on our outline.
Mr. Chairman,
yeah.
Just sure. I read the request for special parking permit, and I thought that was predicated on 7 spots on Church Street being called out.
Why don't we? We'll talk about that when we get to item D on parking in great detail. We'll have time to make sure we look at that. You're close. Yeah, I'm trying to remember what. We will get to that parking as an item, and okay. We'll make sure we have a good answer to that at this point. Okay. Next item on the line, agenda item was pedestrian traffic flow. Why don't you start and kind of give a discussion on the site, how where people are going to get in and out of this thing, and then maybe expand it as to where you think people are going to be coming from a walking standpoint.
from a site perspective, the sidewalks on Church Street and Main Street are full width for pedestrians, so those are going to maintain where we have to cut underneath them, or we'll take them up and put them back the way they are. So that pedestrian access is going to be maintained. If you were starting from the right of the plan, if you're parking in that parking lot, the access is to the entrance on Church Street that's handicapped, so they'll be able to walk directly from the parking area to that doorway and then into the building. Anywhere from Main Street, pedestrians that are not parking, maybe coming from Town Hall or some of the other lots, would go directly from the sidewalk into the main building, either through the steps or the handicapped accessible walkway.
Are all the doors going to be kind of open during normal hours, or?
During normal hours, they'll both be opened. The Main Street entrance is kind of our grand entrance, but both are going to be accessible for pedestrians to come in. At night, when the library is closed and we may have a meeting, it's just going to be the Main Street entrance open.
So then you would go in just right through yes, the new glass doors?
Or? Yes.
Okay. Yep. Questions anyone has on pedestrian traffic flow?
If I can, looking at the pedestrian access and then going back, I hate to go back to the traffic study, but if you have an activity at night, you're going to have people parking on both sides of Main Street and behind Town Hall if parking's available. And going back to an only right turn on Main Street, I think if you, right now the pedestrian walkway is on the west side of Church. So now you're throwing pedestrians crossing on the west side of Church and people making a left-hand turn out of Church Street to go left. I think you're asking for problems. It seems to make sense having the pedestrian walkway on the west side if you're going to have traffic go right. But if you're going to have people crossing and traffic trying to cut through the people crossing and all the other traffic, I think you're throwing too much into that intersection.
So it sounds like you're supporting a no left turn line?
Based on now looking at the pedestrian access, I think that might make sense.
Will that also have people parking in that parking zone? Because that'll be available when the library's closed. And we still have that sidewalk coming all the way down from there on the east side to the front entrance as well. So. But I jotted down the right turn only is what we're looking at. Yeah. So we'll take a look at that and maybe right turn only during certain hours.
That might make a lot of sense as a compromise. Yeah.
I don't know if this is the place to bring it up, or we'll bring it up later where we're talking about handicap access ramp, but handicap pedestrian traffic, are they able to move from the back parking lot where, I'm not sure right now if there's one space or two spaces, I've seen plans with one space, I've seen plans with two spaces, how do they access the building? Is there, do they have to go all the way down Church to Main?
No, the side entrance is fully ADA compliant.
The side entrance is going through.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. But they also can get down and come in that way as well. But it seems
then
like
you've got to
come
off the
side.
Ramps.
Right.
Okay. I had a thought and I've lost it, I guess, at this point. Any other questions from the public about pedestrian traffic flow? Oh, I know what my question was. If I remember from the report, the parking at St. John's is still being worked on with the town.
I think there's some discussions going on about that. Yeah.
And if that was the overflow parking, then it makes sense to keep the traffic kind of going in that direction. And then you're also going to have the pedestrians coming up that. When we had DPW director here earlier on the trees on Ash Street, one of the questions he asked was, where should we put the next sidewalk? We do the sidewalk plan. And one of the suggestions was maybe on the east side of Church Street, down to Church Place, which would allow sidewalks on both sides of the road that would kind of help this project and help maybe the neighborhood too. So that I'm not suggesting that that be part of this project, but maybe in concept of where we go next with our sidewalk budget, that would be a possibility of adding to it. Our witching hour is here. It's 10 o'clock. Elaine, what time do we have to continue on? Our next meeting is actually on a Tuesday, which is the 15th of September.
The hearing before that is scheduled for 8 o'clock.
This was the solar. So we're probably down to a half an hour on that. 8:30. Look for a motion to continue to 8:30 on.
That's the soonest meeting. That's our next meeting.
Yep, that's our next meeting. 8:30 on the 15th of September.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion. Seeing none. How do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carried. Thank you all for coming.
Any chance of doing a special playable meeting for this project?
We have a bunch of people that are going to be out in the next week or two. Okay. Navigation right now.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Yep.